friends, this is Dr. Vijay, consultant surgical oncologist from Apollo CPCC Cancer Care, Ahmedabad.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Rushit Shah, medical oncologist from Apollo CPCC Cancer Care, Ahmedabad.
As you all know, from past 3 weeks, we were doing topics on sarcoma awareness. The first week, we have done a topic on bone cancers, which are osteosarcomas, followed by next week about soft tissue sarcomas. And this week, we are going to talk about sarcomas which affect the gastrointestinal tract, the most common of which are gastrointestinal stromal tumors. Before going into the topic, gastrointestinal tract is a very long tract in the body, which starts right from the oral cavity and ends in the anal canal, comprises of esophagus or the food pipe, stomach, small intestine, large intestine, the rectum and the anal canal. So these tumors which we are going to discuss this week have a tendency to occur anywhere in the GIP, right from esophagus, stomach or anywhere. Most commonly these are seen in the stomach, and most commonly they tend not to spread if they occur in the stomach and if they are in a very smaller size. The main reason for these are genetic mutations. Majority of the times, and in few situations, they may just occur as a part of a familial syndrome which is inherited. And the next important point about gastrointestinal stromal tumors is that these tumors cause a lot of confusing symptoms which may clash with the normal routine cancers of the GIP as well. And definitely only the tissue diagnosis would make us understand that the patient is suffering from GIST. So having said this, what would be the symptoms of very smaller size? The main reason for these are genetic mutations. Majority of the times, and in few situations, they may just occur as a part of a familial syndrome, which is inherited. And the next important point about gastrointestinal stromal tumors is that these tumors cause a lot of confusing symptoms which may clash with the normal routine cancers of the GIP as well. And definitely only the tissue diagnosis would make us understand that the patient is suffering from GIST. So having said this, what would be the symptoms of a patient when he presents with GIST tumors?
So many a times the patients having just asymptomatic or completely asymptomatic in fact, and this tumor is detected incidentally while undergoing ultrasonography or CT scan, they are suspected and patient underwent the biopsy and it is detected. But otherwise, if patient is symptomatic, then one of the most common symptom is pain in the abdomen. That is pain in the particular area or generalized abdominal pain. Second common symptom is bleeding per rectum or bleeding in the stool, passing blood in the stool. It is developed due to the fact that this tumor just tend to develop in the wall of the intestine or stomach, just beneath the epithelium and in between the epithelium or and the outer covering of the intestine or stomach. So when they expand, the tumor tend to expand and it may cause breach in the epithelium. So by that, the bleeding may occur and it is passed, the blood is passed in the stool. So bleeding is one of the common symptoms. One of the common symptoms is swelling or lump in the abdomen. So patient may feel like some lump is there in the abdomen at a particular site. So it is also one of the common symptoms. So a patient usually tend to present with this kind of symptoms, or he or she may be asymptomatic. So when we suspect this diagnosis of any tumor, first of all, it is not GIST, but we may suspect that it may be a soft tissue tumor. So how do we proceed with it?
So as in all other cases, we would definitely take a proper history in a chronological order, then do a local examination, a systemic examination, and then come to a certain doubt that there might be a pathology arising from particular part of the intestinal tract, maybe even in the stomach also. Accordingly, we would think about our investigations, the next step of follow-up. So if at all the patient is presenting with a blood vomiting or blood in the stools, in that scenario definitely we would do a endoscopy, which may be an upper GI endoscopy or a lower GI endoscopy depending on what symptom the patient is presenting with. Second thing, we would also do a minimum to minimum of an ultrasound examination initially in the very beginning stages, or directly going ahead with a contrast enhanced CT scan to know the location of the tumor, size of the tumor, if at all, what is the pathology in it. So the second part would come to a tissue diagnosis. Once we know that the location of the tumor is there, then we need to know what is it actually. So which can be done by an, again, the endoscopic endoscopy, which we do. So that if the specimen, if we can take the biopsy directly, like as you have told, if the epithelial breach is there, then we can directly take a biopsy. If the epithelial breach is not there, it is just beneath the normal looking, normal appearing mucosa, then we would send an ultrasound wave signals to know the location of the tumor, and in that area we go in and put in a needle and take the sample out of it. Do a run a battery of tests, including an immunohistochemistry on that particular specimen to know what type of tumor it is and if there are, if it is associated with any mutations or not. After this, we need to know the staging of the tumor also, depending on the size of the tumor and the location. Sometimes these have a tendency to spread elsewhere in the body, so we need to know that either by a normal CT scan of the thorax, abdomen, and pelvis, or directly with an PET scan, which will give us the entire picture. And also in certain scenarios, we may have to utilize MRI if it is particularly in the anorectal area and of that region, or sometimes even the liver. So these are certain situations where MRI has a role. Per se, PET scan is not required in all cases, but unless if, suppose if the metastasis are there, or if we are giving a neo, I mean before the surgery, if we are giving certain treatment for assessment, we can use PET scan later on. So in those cases, definitely PET scan will have a role. So, and there are certain other scenarios where we need not do an endoscopy to take the biopsy and directly go ahead and take a biopsy. If the metastases are known from before, then we can directly do a biopsy from the, if at all the liver is involved or something like that. So once these are understood, once these tests are done, why is it important to know the mutation or the genetic analysis of this particular tumor, and how is it going to affect the treatment?
Right, so after the biopsy has been done and sample has been taken, first of all we assess it under microscope, and usually it is a spindle cell that are seen in the microscope. Under the microscope, the morphology is a spindle cell variant most of the time. So after confirming it, we go for IHC or immunohistochemistry, where we run a series of markers on the tissue and we confirm it as a GIST, the diagnosis as a GIST. And after confirming the diagnosis, particularly where neoadjuvant chemotherapy is needed or advanced GIST, we may go for the molecular markers, that is some mutations in the KIT gene that we assess, and based on that we may increase the dose of the treatment, which we will be discussing in our subsequent time. So they may have prognostic impact also and predictive impact also, these mutations. So how the patient is going to do and how the treatment is going to work, that information we may get on assessing this advanced molecular markers. So that is the thing. So after this, all these things, we usually, if patient is a candidate for surgery and it is resectable, we usually go for surgery. So what are the surgical modalities actually?
Surgery has definitely got a very important role in treating these tumors. It all depends upon the scenario of the presentation and sometimes the location of the tumor. What are we going to do? If the tumor is very small, localized disease, even without any symptoms, we can still go ahead and resect that tumor, so allowing it not to grow. In certain scenarios, the patient may land up in obstruction, like you have told, sudden symptoms like bleeding or obstruction. In those cases, there is no other option to go in and operate. But in few scenarios, we tend to see the tumor has grown up to a certain large extent or involving certain other crucial organs or the nearby organs in that area, where if we go ahead for surgery, then we may have to resect those organs. In those scenarios, we definitely give neoadjuvant therapy, shrink the disease, and then plan for surgery. This is one scenario. And one more scenario is that crucial organs of the body, crucial functions, where the rectal, the anal canal and the rectum junction of the anorectal junction, where the sphincter mechanism is there, in those areas, and also in the gastroesophageal junction, there is also certain sphincter mechanisms are there. If the gist is arising in those organs, and if you are trying to remove that, the sphincter mechanism may get hampered. Definitely, these are certain locations where, irrespective of the size of the tumor, a neoadjuvant therapy has to be given to shrink the tumor to a certain extent that we can get away with a normal, simple resection rather than compromising on the function of the function related to that particular site.
So the other role is in case of metastasis, where the disease has spread from the gastrointestinal tract to other organs. Usually it is in the liver. In these scenarios, we use neoadjuvant therapy, which as you have mentioned about the neoadjuvant targeted therapy. And particularly if the disease has got responded very well, and we are also sure that we can definitely resect the tumor in toto. In these scenarios, the role of metastatectomy is there. And otherwise, in rest of the situations, surgery, so it, like as I mentioned, depending on the situation, depending on the tumor size, location, and also the functional aspect of the organ where the tumor has gotten. So these are certain things which we keep in mind when we are deciding upon whether to go ahead with surgery or not. So either upfront or at a delayed stage, surgery has definitely got a role. So after talking about the role of surgery in gastrointestinal stromal tumors, what do you say about the medical onco aspect of it?
So as a medical oncologist, our role in GIST is mainly giving targeted therapy, not chemotherapy. So for those patients who are upfront operable and are operated, so we assess the final histopathological report and we divide our patient into low risk, intermediate risk or high risk. Depending on upon the location of the tumor, how the big the tumor is, size of the tumor, and whether the tumor is ulcerated or divided or resected in total, and number of mitoses that we see in the microscope. So based on this factor, for high-risk patients, we usually give imatinib, that is the oral targeted therapy, for 36 months total, that is up to 3 years. And after that, we keep patients on follow-up. So this was about high-risk patients who have undergone surgery. So another role of targeted therapy is in locally advanced cases where the lesion is not upfront operable. For those patients, we prescribe again imatinib for usually 6 to 10 months depending upon the response, and we assess the response every 2 to 3 months till maximum response is achieved. And then we, after the maximum response is achieved, we usually go for surgery. So this was the role regarding neoadjuvant treatment. The third important role is in metastatic settings. So for those patients, we start upfront targeted therapy. And again, for those patients, we usually assess every 2 to 3 months. And if significant response is achieved and the both the local part as well as the metastatic lesions become operable, at that point of time, we can think of undergoing surgery also. So for metastatic patients, we do sometimes assess the molecular markers also to know the sensitivity of the tumor to a particular drug. So this was regarding role of medical oncology in treatment of GIST.
So I think we have covered almost all the basic topics related to gastrointestinal stromal tumors.
Right.
So this is it for this week, guys. So if you have any suggestions, any comments, please do let us know on the comment section below or on our personal web pages. So next week, we will again come back with a very nice topic. We are thinking to do a topic on lung, as August 1st is Lung Cancer, World Lung Cancer Day. So let us meet again. Till then, thank you.
Thank you.